best scene in Vancouver. Get down or lay down.
Hayes Entertainment.
The number one sports podcast in Vancouver with Ryan Hayes and Big Mike. Roll it up and fire it up.
Hayes ENT in the building. It's the season finale of season one. This one really hits home. This one's my favorite. Interviewing my childhood.
Ryan Hayes and Big Mike.
Theo Fleury.
I Only Touch Greatness Podcast.
This season we've interviewed a bunch of big names. From Kelly Rudy, Clint Malarchuk, Shane Corson. We got UFC fighters Mark Hunt, Tanner the Bulldozer Buzzer, Lance Gibson. We interviewed Jamie Soleil, the Olympic skater. We've interviewed all the top prospects in the draft this year and the following year, and ones that are already been drafted. They're a bunch of good Canadian kids. This one is the season finale. We have my childhood hero on, Theo Fleury. It's I Only Touch Greatness podcast. It's Ryan Hayes. Big Mike's away today, but he is here in thought.
This is I Only Touch Greatness podcast with Ryan Hayes.
We're going live.
We've
got Theo Fleury in the building right now.
We're going live.
All right. I had to pull the Theo jersey out of the hockey bag there.
Love it.
Smells like hockey gear, though.
Awesome.
I can't put that on in my Canuck house. So, 87 World Junior Brawl. You probably get asked about that all the time.
I get asked about it all the time, yep.
Yeah, they had to turn off the lights, and pretty much you started that, didn't you?
I was on the ice when it happened, yeah. So whether I started it or not, I don't think I'm pleading the fifth.
The goal you scored, the overtime winner, sliding on your knees back in the 89?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was my goal celebration growing up.
Awesome.
I also wear, you have a 14 tattoo, correct?
No, I don't.
Oh, I thought you had a number 14 tattoo.
No, I don't, no.
Okay, well, I got 14 tatted on me, and I wear number 14 because of you.
Awesome. So, the 87 brawl in the World Junior was, you know, the interesting thing was that, you know, in the Western League at that time, like it was happening every night. Like there was either a bench scoring brawl or a line brawl or, you know, whatever it was. And so it was an interesting experience for sure. But I think what happened the year after was probably more important, you know, that we went right into Moscow, Soviet Union, Communist Russia, and we beat the Russians in the same rink that Paul Henderson scored the goal in 1972. So, you know, and the Russians had a line of Fedorov, McGilney, and Bure. That was their number one line.
It's a hell of a line.
And so we used a line of Adam Graves, Robbie DeMaio, and Mark Recchi. Check those guys into the ice that night. So, you know, it was an amazing experience to, you know, to win a World Junior. And I think it was like the third gold that we had won, like ever at that time. And so, you know, I think we put the World Junior tournament on the map when we had the brawl, you know.
Yeah, definitely. That's what I read too, that you had to. I was born in 83, so I was young enough. That was like my first hockey memory was that World Junior tournament.
Yeah. Well, and you know, CBC was they were the broadcasters, so it was interesting. And to see what it's become, you know, today is pretty cool.
Yeah, it's definitely one of the biggest tournaments out there right now.
Well, I think it's the greatest hockey tournament on the planet.
That's for sure. I enjoy it. I enjoy watching it every Christmas time.
Yeah. And I played in two of them, and You know, I have really fond memories. And, you know, probably my favorite championship of all of them is the World Junior, because it was the first one that I won. And, you know, after that and having that feeling of winning, you know, you just want to have it more and more and more and more.
And then after the line brawl, to come back the following year and take down the Russians that you had fought with.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. So.
So you had a hell of a,
Joe Sakic was the fourth line centerman on that team.
Yeah, that's how long. Yeah, you had a hell of a cup run with the Colorado Avalanche that year.
Yeah.
Should have been a cup run.
Yeah, it was. That was a sick team, you know. Like, it was like playing on an all-star team, really, at the end of the day, you know. And unfortunately, you know, we ran into a really good Dallas Stars team who, you know, played a real sort of boring defensive game. And, you know, Eddie Balfour had a great series. And, yeah, so unfortunately that happens, you know.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay, here's a good question. What was going through your mind this past year when all these coaches started getting fired?
Well, it's sort of, you know, the world we live in now, you know. And, you know, it's a different kind of hockey player, you know. One that, you know, I'm definitely not familiar with. You know, I have a couple kids that age, and so, you know, it's a different time, it's a different era. You know, social media is now, you know, such an important part of, you know, everyday lives. You know, it's where we get our news from, it's where we get everything from. So, you know, it's unfortunate that but, you know, it forces us to adjust and to you know, try to be better. And yeah.
So, good friend of our show, Shane Corson.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, he told me you guys roomed together at the 98 Olympics.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We spent a lot of time in the what is it? The Village cafeteria. So, yeah, that was fun. It was fun. Yeah, Corson is a good guy. Really good guy. Good teammate.
Yeah, and feel free to say whatever you like on here. No holds barred.
Yeah.
Corson told us a bunch of good stories.
Yeah.
You also won 2002 gold at Salt Lake City.
Yes. Unbelievable.
Matthew Barnaby. He's one of your good friends, right?
Yes. Played with him in New York. Yeah. Good guy. Good dude. Tough guy. Really tough guy.
How is he staying busy these days?
I think he's got his own show now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so he's doing – I, you know what? I don't really stay in touch with a whole lot of guys. You know, I'm so busy doing, you know, this other work that, you know, and I'm I was traveling pretty much somewhere different every week for the last 10 years. So, yeah, it's been so I'm sort of transitioning all of my stuff online and hopefully have all that stuff out in a couple weeks. So looking forward to that.
Okay. We'll definitely be giving that a share and help spreading the word. We're going to get into those questions a little later. I just wanted to run through your NHL career right now. Okay. This Battle of the Blades. You were on with Jamie Salle.
Yeah. Amazing experience. Yeah. That was, that was one of the hardest things I've ever done, but obviously one of the most rewarding. It was, you know, those skates are trippy, you know? And, Jamie's a quality human being. She's fearless. She's tough, you know? And, I really enjoyed, you know, spending those 3 or 4 months together, you know, skating and training and, so.
Yeah. We had her on last week to interview her.
Oh, good.
Yeah. And so we brought up the question, oh, you were with Theo on the Battle of the Blades, and she said that you were really, because you've got the drive and you always want to win, so it really hurt you and you didn't get a chance to win that or go to the next round.
Yeah, it was a difficult pill to swallow for sure. So I've never finished sixth in anything in my life. So, the experience was incredible. Like it was so much fun, you know. And I actually became a better skater, if you can believe that. You know,
I'm pretty sure I've seen a video on YouTube where you pulled off like a triple cow sow.
We called it the cowboy axle.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So eighth round draft pick, 166 overall in the 87 draft. Going into the draft, what were your expectations? And once you were drafted, how did that feel?
Well, it was actually 20 rounds had gone by, because the first year I was eligible, I didn't get picked.
Okay.
And I think I had, 110 points that year or something. And so I didn't get drafted. And then the following year, I made the world junior team, the Brawl team.
Yep.
And, got picked in the eighth round. And, what I always tell kids is that it doesn't matter the number, right? Yep. It's what you do with that opportunity. And all I ever wanted was a chance, right? And so the Flames gave me that chance, gave me that opportunity. And, I came to my first training camp with basically the whole entire organization not believing that I could maybe someday be an NHL player. And when I left that camp, everybody believed that maybe one day I could. And so, I took that opportunity and I made the most of it. I actually got into 3 exhibition games that year. And so I came there, I think I finished first in the fitness test, And so, all those little things, really, really impressed Cliff Fletcher and Al McNeil, Al Coates, the coaching staff. I actually had Crispy at the under 18. He was a coach at the under 18. So he was familiar with me and had coached me before. And so, obviously, I have tons of respect for Crispy because he gave me, the chance and the opportunity to play. And then obviously, 18 months later, we were carrying the Stanley Cup around the Montreal Forum. So,
oh yeah, that's it. One of my next questions was the 89 Cup run. Mm-hmm. What's it like, or what did it feel like when you won the Stanley Cup so early in your career?
This is the greatest day of my life.
I really appreciated, as much as I do now. I believe we probably should have won maybe one more, maybe two more with the, the talent that we had. I could not have been put in a better situation, to be mentored by that group of guys early on in my career was very special, to me. And, I learned a lot about what you're supposed to be like as a professional hockey player. To hang around with guys like Lanny and Poplinski and Hunter and Neuendijk and Gilmore and Vernon, and the list goes on and on and on and on. Joey Mullen, Colin Patterson, Rick Walmsley, Rick Natras, Jamie McCowan, Brad McCrimmon, Gary Suter, Al McInnes, that team was stacked.
Definitely is. And a couple names you brought up there we'll be interviewing in the next couple weeks. You got Tim Hunter and Colin Patterson coming
on. Awesome, that's great. Those guys are awesome guys. You'll love them. They're good.
Okay,
good quality human beings, those two.
Yeah, I've met Tim Hunter before, because he's coaching in the Dub, right? So mm-hmm. I see him when he comes to Giants games.
Yeah.
You still have your annual golf tourney for Crohn's disease?
No, I after I came out with my story, I sort of switched from that space to, you know, the space of trauma, mental health, and addiction. And we have a foundation here called the Breaking Free Foundation, where we support all trauma survivors. And, you know, we've ran that, geez, I don't even know how many years now. It's more than five. I know that. And, yeah, so that keeps us busy, and it's, we provide a lot of support and, you know, sort of a safe space for people to heal. So
good. It's been great. You definitely do a lot of public speaking. I see you always around. I just even this morning watched that public speaking you went down to Nashville to do.
It was that's right. Yeah. Yeah.
Some of my questions later on, we're going to touch on that episode. That's near the end of my page of notes here.
All right.
So you had 1,084 games, 1,088 points, point of game player at least. You should have been in the hall this year.
Well, you know, they only induct four people at a time, right?
Yeah.
And there are many guys worthy of, you know, that honor. And so, you know, I think I'm just kind of resigned to the fact that I just got to wait my turn, and hopefully that day will come. And, you know, that they feel that, you know, I'm worthy of the title. But I was certainly overjoyed and happy that Jerome got in yesterday. You know, quality human being, great hockey player, tough as nails, you know, he could do it all. And so, you know, obviously, very, very, very deserving, of that honor. And, you know, I'm happy for his family. I know his dad really well, and he's quite the character and good guy, and his mom's great. So yeah, I'm happy for him.
Yeah, definitely. We've ran into him a few times in the Okanagan.
Yeah, absolutely. He lives in Kelowna.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah.
Okay. Why is pain the greatest motivator?
Well, I think that it it allows us to make changes in our life, right? You know, nobody enjoys being in pain, right? And it is a clear sign from the universe that maybe we should try to do it a different way, you know? And, you know, 16 years ago, I had a fully loaded pistol in my mouth ready to pull the trigger, not because I wanted to end my life, but I was exhausted from living in emotional pain and suffering for, you know, the majority of my life. And I knew that if I continued down the path and down the road that I was on, that, you know, eventually that would happen. And I knew that I was better than what I was showing the world. And so September 18th, 2005 was the day that I took my last drink and my last drug. And, you know, it's been almost 5,400 days, you know, that, I've been clean and sober. And, it's a different way to live, but, it's probably, the only way to live, you know. Drinking and doing drugs is no longer an option, you know. And there are many different ways that we can heal, and there are many different modalities that you can use to, you know, make yourself better, well, you know. But I think the most important thing is that, you know, I have a relationship with myself, something that I didn't have before.
Yeah.
And the direct result of that is that all of my other relationships in my life have improved as well. You know, the kind of people that I attract in my life now are completely different than the ones that I used to when I was drinking. Right. And so, you know, choosing a life of sobriety and choosing a life of helping people, I think is the reason why we're all on this earth. Right.
Congratulations on 15 years at least.
Thank
15
you.
And a half, I think.
Well, it's 14. It'll be 15 in September. So,
okay. Congratulations on that. And I drink a lot, but it's I never really considered a problem until I started watching more and more stuff on the way that I act. I wake up the next day and I'm like, oh man, why did I say something so stupid? Or why did I do something so stupid? And then these things start piling up and you never get really the chance to talk about them until they boil over and then you do something.
Yeah. Well, the guilt and the shame, right? The guilt and the shame really kind of holds that all in place. And so, you know, until you find a safe place where you can talk about that stuff, which there aren't very many, you know, in the world, you know, and that's why, you know, mental health and addiction is probably at its all-time high of epidemic proportions. And it's because we, you know, we haven't created a safe space. And so, you know,
how did you find that safe space?
You know what? I was sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I said, you know what? I'm just going to tell my story and see what happens. And what happened was, you know, I got completely nothing but love, support, respect, you know, and then other people started coming and saying, hey man, I read your book and, you know, thank you for telling my story. Me too. Right. And you know, that hasn't stopped, you know, it's been, like I said, I've been doing this for 10 years and, you know, every day I get an email or a private message on social media where people are, you know, telling me their story.
Yeah, I was in that interview that I referenced earlier when you were in Nashville, you said that there was a lineup of 400 people in Toronto at your first book signing. And the guy came up to you and told you that he had part of the Me Too movement.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that changed my life. That right there gave me purpose, right? When I had none, right? I was sort of kind of, you know, I was transitioning from my professional hockey career into, you know, and I had no idea what the rest of my life was going to look like because, you know, all I had was a, you know, grade 12 diploma from Vanier Collegiate in Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan. Yeah. That's all I had, you know? And so I didn't really prepare for life after hockey. And so the book really, you know, sort of thrust me into this space of helping people, you know, recover from whatever it is they need to recover from.
And when somebody comes up to you and says that, do you feel great? Like, or like, 'cause you're getting a chance to speak out and educate these people, and when somebody has a chance to thank you for it,
well, first of all, I have a lot of empathy for them, right? Because I know how much pain they're in and how long they've been in that pain, right? Where they haven't been able to express, you know, the truths about their life. And so, you know, empathy is first, caring is first, and then, you know, asking them, you know, thank you for sharing that with me. And now what do you want to do? Like, where do you want to go? All right. But what's interesting is, you know, I would say 9 times out of 10, I don't really have to say anything, you know, as long as I'm attuned and present, you know, sometimes that's all people need is just somebody to listen.
Yes.
Without judgment, without, you know, all this stigma that's attached to telling your truth.
You won a Canadian Humanitarian Award, right?
Yes, I did. I would have never thought that you know, my life would be this, you know, life after hockey would be, you know, this and way more impactful than my hockey career, you know, and you know, I say I'm in the space of saving lives. Yeah. And ultimately, you know, like I said earlier, I think that's the real reason why we're all here, you know,
and you
should be allowed to tell your story, whichever way you want to tell it, because it's your story.
Yeah.
It's nobody else's, but your story. And, you know, by me finding the strength and the courage to use my voice to talk about my pain and suffering changed my life, right? Because what I realized was not only was I not the only person, but, you know, this is bigger than we could possibly imagine, how many people that suffer with traumatic experiences. And then that subsequently, you know, causes us lots of mental health issues and addiction issues. And so, you know, to be sort of an example of, you know, recovery was pretty amazing stuff.
So you have a country band too.
We have a country band. Yep.
You got an album. Who am I?
Yeah, well, I am who I am. Yeah. You know, I grew up around country music. My grandpa was a fiddle player. My dad was a guitar player. And so, you know, my fondest memories as a child were sitting beside my grandfather, listening to him play the fiddle. And then, you know, after I wrote the book, I was like, geez, I can write a book. Maybe I can write some tunes. And so, you know, I had a couple buddies in the music industry that, you know, were very successful. And I called them up and said, hey, you know, be interested in, you know, writing some songs with me. They both said, yeah, we'd love to. And, you know, all of a sudden, here we go. We got an album. And, you know, we do some live shows every once in a while. And, yeah, it's a lot of fun, you know.
And you wrote a song for the Madden in 2017, yes. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Crazy how this all kind of, you know, come together. But yeah, it's been fun. I enjoy the process of writing songs. It's very cathartic.
And a few minutes ago, you said that you've impacted more people after hockey than you did during hockey. But even during hockey, you impacted me growing up, being the smallest guy, 5 feet tall,
right.
150 pounds. Like, I play beer league still, and I'm still dirty. Like, I'm hacking, I'm throwing body checks, just like you.
Nice.
I'm tossed. I led the whole Burnaby 8 rinks on in penalties for all 10 divisions.
Nice.
Oh, yeah, because I'm a little guy. If the big guys can't stand getting hit by the little guy, then they get off the ice.
Yeah, I get it.
But did you have any pregame rituals?
Yeah, too many to talk about, that's for sure. I was probably borderline OCD when it came to, you know, preparing for the games. But, you know, it really sort of – you know, got me in a frame of mind to get myself ready to compete at the highest level every single night, you know. So, especially, you know, when you're playing against guys that are 6 inches taller than you and 50 pounds heavier than you, right? You know, you have to prepare yourself mentally to, you know, for that challenge every single night. So, you know.
Yep, that's where the stick in the back of the legs, you give them a couple of whacks and just chop them down to our height.
Yep. That's right. The stick is the great equalizer.
Yeah. Did you have any pregame music? Like, was there a favorite song you went to?
No, I just, I used to have one of those old Discmen.
Yeah.
Right. Because not a lot of guys on my team like country music.
Yeah.
Right. So I was a big country music guy. And so, you know, and I liked the older stuff, you know, Willie Nelson, Waylon Jennings, Bach Owens, you know, those kind of guys. And so, you know, if I ever put that on the big stereo in the dressing room,
guys would start losing it.
It would be quickly turned off for sure.
So do you play, you still play hockey?
I probably play 5 or 6 games a year.
With the Flames alumni or?
Yeah, Flames alumni. And I go to Mario Lemieux's fantasy camp in Pittsburgh every year. So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, okay, here's a question for you. If people run into you and they see you out on the street and they're asking for autographs, do you take it in and autograph, or do you not like it? Oh, okay.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You enjoy having people still?
Yeah, of course. You know, without the fans, there is no me. There is no NHL, right? And so people don't buy tickets to the game if they don't buy jerseys. if they don't buy hockey cards, you know, there is no us. And so, you know, it's our obligation to embrace, you know, every kind of fan, you know. And, you know, I still get tons of fan mail with hockey cards and 8x10s and all kinds of stuff. And I sign them and send them back.
Hey, that's awesome. Did you have a favorite sports hero growing up?
Geez. Well, in the NHL, it was any small guy that was having success, right? You know, guys like Mats Naslund and Dennis Marouk and Denny Savard, you know, these kind of guys were, you know, were doing well. And so gave me hope, right? Gave me hope. So I'm glad that I was able to sort of pass that on to, you know, other kids that were vertically challenged.
Yeah, like me.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, like me and Marshawn.
Yeah.
Yep. St. Louis.
Yeah, for sure. And now Johnny Hockey here in Calgary. So yeah, it's great.
So we had Clint Malarchuk on a couple weeks ago. Actually last weekend. He was telling us a good story about you guys. You offered him a ride to the airport, 3-hour drive.
Yeah. 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 It was really good to get to know him. You know, he's got a hell of a story.
Yeah, he talked for hours about his story.
Yeah.
And that's why I could see you two getting along pretty good about that.
Yeah,
for sure. Really nice guy, Clint Malarchuk.
Yeah. Awesome guy. Yeah.
Yeah. We actually had Kelly Rudy on, too, last week.
Oh, good. Yeah, another good guy.
Yeah, definitely. Why did you choose number 14?
They just gave it to me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I would have wore 1/4 if they gave it to me.
Just to play in the NHL.
Yeah, that's right.
Growing up short, were you bullied? I mean, I was bullied as a kid.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. But,
you know, I was always, I was always a fighter, right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, I would always challenge the bullies, right?
So see, I use that as, I look at all the people that either picked on me or because I was short or little or tried to bully me, and I use that as fire nowadays to drive me to always do good, to start a podcast. I used to run a record label, and I excelled at that as well. So
yeah,
you get these things that people tell you can't do something, and then you got to break those boundaries of them trying to hold you down.
Yeah, there's no question that, you know, there we all face challenges, right? Yeah. We all face challenges, and you know, it's what you do with them experiences that, you know, that make the most of it.
I heard a story that Trump's plane used to pick you up after the game, the helicopter, and take you downtown and to go gambling. Is that true?
I would go from the piers right behind Madison Square Garden to Atlantic City.
Yeah. Take him to a casino where he gambled and partied all night, then take him back to New York in time for practice.
Whenever we had a day off, I'd always head to Atlantic City.
Why do people turn to drugs when they have pain? Do you think?
Well, it's a coping mechanism, right? Yeah. drugs and alcohol and food and sex and gambling and you name it, you know, sort of suppress, you know, that emotional pain. It's not physical pain, it's emotional pain. And, you know, because like I said, we haven't really created a space in society where we can talk about this emotional pain or our trauma, right? What happened to us. And, you know, has it gotten better? Yeah, obviously. Do we have a long ways to go? Yeah, we got a long ways to go. But, you know, each and every day, you know, I can see that there is a change happening. And, you know, like I hate the word addiction because it has so much shame attached to it. And it has sort of the moniker of, you know, well, just stop drinking. Well, or just stop using. And I'm like, well, it's not that simple, right? You know, it's about, you know, finding someone or a group of people where you can sort of unload all of this trauma that we've experienced in life. And then when we do that and we feel safe, like, you know, the world changes for us because we realize that not only is my experience, like it's not different, right? Everybody has struggles. Everybody goes through some sort of emotional pain in their life, and it's so easy and so accessible, right? You know, when you consider during COVID that the dope shops and the liquor stores were considered essential services, you know? Yeah. So, you know, what does that say?
Yeah, and I find it for me, like, as much as I talked earlier about how I, and mine, it's like, how do I go to a Canuck game? Because I have season tickets to the Canucks. How do I go to a game and not have a couple beers when I got all these people around me? How do I watch football on Sundays when I got all friends around you drinking? Mm-hmm. I feel I almost need to change my whole circle of people around me.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's what I had to do, right? Yeah. You know, I had to start hanging around with people that were sober and, you know, doing the deal every day, right? And but what's happened is the quality of people that are in my life as opposed to, you know, before. You know, what's interesting, somebody said to me one time, they said, you know, you want to find out who your real friends are? Get sober.
Yeah.
Okay? So I got sober. I had like 500 phone numbers in my iPhone. And so I called all 500 numbers and I said, listen, I made a choice, made a decision, not drinking, not going to bars, not doing drugs. So don't ask me to do that. But if you'd like to come to my house, I'll cook you a nice dinner. First time in our relationship, we'll actually have a meaningful conversation. You know how many friends I got left? Two. Two of 500. Right? Yeah. But that's all I needed.
One of them's done.
No, they're still around, right? You know, my two buddies are still around because they wanted to see me sober, right? And now, you know, they're both sober too.
That's
right.
That's good.
So, you know, I had to change absolutely everything, right? And now I have this incredible life,
yeah,
right? You know?
Something I really need to think about, maybe.
Yeah. And you know what I call the 498? My 10 o'clock friends.
Okay.
Because you know what happens at 10 o'clock?
Yeah.
Everybody gets fucking loaded, and it's like, man, I love you, man. You know what I mean? Like, it's, you know, it's like, come on.
Right? Yeah, definitely. I know what kind of people those are, too.
Yeah.
If I got a few more questions, and if you got time, okay. How did starting the book Playing with Fire come to start? Like, I know the background story, but in your interview, I watched you talked about meeting a friend's wife.
Yeah. Yeah. I happened to be at a Calgary Flames alumni golf tournament, and, you know, an old media guy that I hadn't seen in a long time, we, you know, started chatting, and at the end of the conversation, I said, you know, do you know anybody be interested in, you know, writing a book with me? And he says, well, my wife is a writer. And so 3 days after that conversation, I met Kirstie. And then 3 days later, we started writing Playing with Fire. And, you know, the rest is sort of history, you know.
In that same interview, I believe you might have been the one in Nashville today. You talked about finding your spirit.
Yeah.
Like, how do you find your spirit after all you've been through?
Well, what happens when, you know, you're sort of abused, neglected, abandoned, you know, whatever, your spirit actually leaves your body. Because even your spirit is like, this is way too much. And, you know, fortunately enough for me, I'm Aboriginal. And, you know, I've been to 420 First Nations communities in the last 10 years. And what's happened is these people have given me my life back spiritually because they've taught me about ceremony. And, you know, I go to sweat lodges, I go to powwows, I go to, you know, and it really sort of fills that piece of spirituality. And my spirit has come back, right? They've taught me how to call that piece of me back, right? And, you know, ultimately, the way we heal is body, mind, spirit, okay. Right? And when we work on all three things and we get them all living in harmony together, that's truly what healing is all about, is healing each one of those parts.
Yeah. Okay. And the part about not good enough, and you got to love yourself first before someone else got, I mean, I'm single, had a few relationships here or there, but like, on the most part, maybe that's it. Maybe I can't love myself yet. That's before I let someone, a woman love me, right?
Yeah, that's it. You know,
how do you find that?
Well, you work on those three things that I just talked about, yep. Right? You know, I have to eat well. I have to sleep well. I have to exercise. That's the physical part, right? I have to heal all of my old injuries that I had. You know, the mind stuff is, you know, I got to find a professional that can help me work through my emotional pain, make sense of it all, right? And then that spirituality piece is what I find that people leave that out. Because most people are pissed off at the G-O-D word,
yep.
God, right? And to me, it ain't about the white bearded guy in the sky, right? I don't get that concept. But I do get the concept of relationship, right? Yep. And that spirituality piece is key in having a relationship with myself, right? Because I can practice spirituality. I don't have to be in a room full of people to practice spirituality. It's what I do, you know, meditate, you know, do breathing exercises, you know, these kind of things are all to me about taking care of myself, right? Because I ran away from myself, right? I abused myself. After the abuse was over, I took over the abuse and I abused myself. Why? Because I didn't think I was good enough. I didn't think I was lovable, you know? And so I had to rebuild, you know, that part of my brain.
Okay. Right?
And, you know, what I was sort of taught writing the second book, Conversations with a Rattlesnake, was I wrote it with a neuroscientist. And basically she told me that I could rewire all of that trauma. And, you know, it's happened. Right.
How many books do you have now? Because I when I was growing up as a young guy, I had the Fury book.
Yeah, yeah. And so I've written three.
Okay, and I have Playing with Fire as well.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't know about the third one. I didn't see that in my notes. Have you ever thought about getting into coaching or scouting or being around the game anymore?
I am coaching right now.
Oh, you are?
It's called life coaching.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
That's definitely true.
Yeah.
Do you look back and you see these highlights, say the chicken dance one or what? Do you look back at these and hate those highlights, or do you look at it as like, that was me then, look at how far I've come along?
Yeah, absolutely. For sure. You know, I was in a really dark place when those things were going on. So
yeah, definitely.
And, but you know, the one thing that, you know, I just love to play the game, right? You know, I hated practice. I didn't like working out, but you throw a puck out on the ice and I'll give you everything I have. I love to compete. Right. And now, you know, I'm in a different space, but I'm still competing, you know, still trying to, you know, I try to be better today than I was yesterday. Right.
is how every day should be.
And I, you know, I do something every day for my recovery, right? Not 10 things, one thing.
One of my notes I have here, you're running on the treadmill and then you decided to call it quits on your career.
Yeah, I think I just had enough, right? Okay. You know, I was no longer willing to pay the price of what it takes to be a professional athlete.
Okay. That was the last question I have written down. You want to go ahead and just tell us how we can check out your website, plug it?
Yep. So my website is steelflurry.life.
Okay.
I'm on social media. On Twitter, I'm at TheoFlurry14. On Instagram, I'm at TheoFlurry14. And then I'm on Facebook and LinkedIn, TheoFlurry.
Okay. Oh, I found another question. You're anti-Trump guy, huh?
Anti-Trump?
Or Trudeau, sorry.
Yes.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, okay. I just want to throw that one in. I'll edit that out after.
No, you don't have to.
Okay. I want to thank you for coming on.
Yeah, my pleasure.
And
hi, everybody. I'm Theo Fleury, and I am on I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Perfect. Thank you, Theo, and I look forward to being in contact with you about this jersey, sending it over to you.
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay, thank you for taking your time today. I appreciate that so much. I couldn't even sleep last night. It was like the day before Christmas Day.
Awesome.
Okay, thank you very much.
I'm glad I could help you out, man.
You did a lot. Thank you very much. Okay,
cheers, man. Take care.
Take care. Bye. Okay, we just wrapped that up. Season finale, season one. I'm pumped. Just interviewed my favorite person in the whole world. If you're paying for features, you got to work on your brand. Look at the list of people we got. Season one's in the books. Season two, we're coming. Look out for that. We're doing it big. Hazy and T. I Only Touch Greatness. And for my guest, Big Mike Patron.
Big Mike.
We'll see you next season. Season 2.
Haze. Haze. Entertainment. Exclusive.